الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise is due to Allah, the Lord of all that exists. I testify that there is no true God worthy of being worshipped except Allah, and that Muhammad is His true slave and messenger. Today's first topic, as you see on the screen, is knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah the Most High, the One free of all imperfection, made Himself known to His creation by His names and attributes, which He had mentioned and affirmed in His book and in the authentic sunnah of His messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyone who contemplates these names and attributes would know of a Lord, of a Rabb, who is the King, who is the ever living, and who is the one who sustains and protects all that exists, that He is free of all wants, and that all creation needs Him, that He had risen on His arsh, on throne, in the most majestic way that befits Him, sees and hears, runs all the affairs, orders and forbids, sends the messengers and books, accepts and rejects, rewards and punishes, gives and takes, lifts whom He wishes in might, and sinks whom He wishes in humility, sees and hears from above seven heavens. He knows all that is manifested and all that is hidden. He does what He wishes. He is perfect and free from any deficiency. No atom can move without His permission. No leaf can fall except that He knows about it. No one can intercede with Him except with His permission. He hears the footsteps of the dark ant on the black rock in the midst of full darkness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Described with all perfection, above any defect, and nothing is like unto Him. He puts everything in its due measures with all justice and all wisdom, and He is greater than everything, and He is most beautiful than everything. These are from the words of the great scholar of Islam, Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah, in his classical book Al-Fawa'id, The Benefits. The slave of Allah needs his creator. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. And if Allah would leave him for other than Him, he would be left to one who might, or who doesn't, or who couldn't bring him harm, or bring upon harm, nor cause him a benefit, nor give him death, or cause him death, nor give him life. He will be enslaved to other than Him. And his life would be meaningless. if he loses the link to his creator. All are in need of Allah. The one whose mercy encompasses everything. And the most perfect of the slaves of Allah are those who worship Him by all of His names and attributes known to us. And that's why the scholars have interpreted the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Inna lillahi ta'ala 99 asma, 100 illa wahida man ahsaha dakhala al-jannah." That Allah, to Allah belongs 99 names, 100 less than one. Anyone who enumerates them will enter paradise. This enumeration is just not the counting in itself, but those it refers to worshipping Allah by His names and attributes, meaning knowing them. And therefore, the most honorable knowledge, the most honorable knowledge and the greatest knowledge is the knowledge of Allah, whom there is no God except Him, the true God, the Lord of all that exists. And the knowledge of Allah is the basis of every other knowledge. For the one who knows of Allah knows other than Him. And the one who is ignorant of Allah, therefore, by all means, he is ignorant of every other thing. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. And don't be like those who forgot Allah because of their disobedience. فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. So He let them forget themselves, so they were not able to do righteous deeds. So if you contemplate this verse, you will find a noble and honorable meaning and a great one implicated in this verse, that anyone who forgets Allah, then Allah will make him forget himself, and therefore will not realize his reality, nor he would realize what benefits him and what harms him. So he will be crippled like cattle. Even cattle could be more knowledgeable of its benefits in this sense. What's meant is that the knowledge of Allah is the basis and foundation of every other knowledge. And it is the basis for the slave of Allah to know of his happiness and to perfect his affairs and to work for his other life. Therefore, he would properly estimate Allah, the proper estimation he deserves, and it will lead him to be shy of Allah out of love and magnification, his heart attached to Him, yearning to meet Allah and to be close to Him, turning his affairs to Him, having awe and fear of Him. And mankind, with this respect, differ in such an estimation of Allah. the Prophet in invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, لا أحصي ثناء عليك. I cannot enumerate praising you. أنت, you as you Allah. Inshallah. As you have praised yourself. The prophets indicating those most knowledgeable of Allah, they even invoke Allah with this saying, لا أحصي ثناء عليك. I cannot enumerate praising you as you have praised yourself, O Allah. Love, eagerness are matters that follow the knowledge of Allah. So the knowledge of Allah brings forth and leads to love of Him and yearning to meet Him. And therefore, I will write down these points. Knowledge of Allah is the most great and most honorable knowledge. And that this leads to that this leads to the proper estimation of Allah, loving Him and eagerness to meet Him. And the more a person is knowledgeable of Allah, the more perfection is in his love of Him. And therefore, فَمَنْ كَانَ يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ وَأَسْمَائِهِ وَصِفَاتِهِ, whoever then believes in Allah and His names and attributes and knows of Him in this respect, he would love Him more. And then he would achieve a state of sweetness in his heart, and this sweetness puts him in a state whereby he would always love to meet Allah and be close to Him and to see and look at His face and listen to Him and to His words. The knowledge itself leads to the, that's why we put the proper estimation. I didn't leave it to lead to estimation of Allah, but the proper estimation, and inshallah there will be inshallah no problem with that. That's why I restricted it with the word proper. So we move, inshallah. Malik bin Dinar, rahimahullah, said, the people of this life, they left it and they didn't taste the best of it. They said to him, and what is it Ya Aba Yahya, O Abu Yahya, what is it? He said, Ma'rifatullahi Azza wa Jal, knowing of Allah, the Most Mighty and Most Majestic, that this would be the most. They didn't, those who know of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those the ones who have really tasted what's the best in this life, and that is therefore the knowledge of Allah the Most High, as Malik bin Dinar rahimahullah asserted. So we continue inshallah with this, and in Surah Al-An'am, sister Muslima, in Surah Al-An'am, in chapter 6, verse 91, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ إِذْ قَالُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ بَشَرٍ مِّنْ شَيْءٍ. They, the Jews, the Quraysh pagans, the idolaters, did not estimate Allah with an estimation due to Him. When they said, nothing did Allah send down to any human being. So, yani inshallah, what's due to Him, that's why we said the proper estimation. So as when the knowledge of Allah is strengthened, then his eagerness to Allah also is strengthened. Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, the believer would not feel at rest without the meeting of his Lord, of Allah. Therefore, anyone who sets his resting, quote unquote, in this life in the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then as if he have reached that. Meaning that the believer, as he started the saying at the beginning of his statement, the believer would not have any real trust or rest in this life without being keen about this matter of meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, really yearning to that so that he can reach it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ra'd, verse 28, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَتَطْمَئِنُّ قُلُوبُهُمْ بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبُ. Those who believed and their hearts had tranquility and peace with the remembrance of Allah, for indeed through the remembrance of Allah the hearts will be in such a state of tranquility. Surah Al-Ra'd, chapter 13, verse 28. So this tranquility and rest, this is the thing which Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was speaking about when he said that there will be no real rest for the believer, you know, unless he meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that therefore this matter should be alive, and to bring it alive, the process, the means, is what is stated in Surah Al-Ra'd, which is chapter 13, verse 28. Those who believe and their hearts are in a state of tranquility and rest, bidhikrillah, through the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will achieve that. And before this, the prophets, may Allah salaam and salam be upon them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them the choice between increasing their stay on earth or death. They used to choose the meeting of Allah the Most High. They used to choose the meeting of Allah the Most Majestic. As Al-Imam Al-Bukhari rahimahullah entitled in his Sahih, in his book of collection of hadith, chapter, quote, من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه. The one who loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet him. And underneath this chapter, he gave the situation with the Prophet ﷺ described by Aisha, his wife, radiallahu ta'ala anha. She said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, used to say, إِنَّهُ لَمْ يُقْبَضْ نَبِيٌّ قَطٌّ حَتَّى يُرَى مَقْعَدَهُ مِنَ الْجَنَّةِ ثُمَّ يُخَيَّرْ. That no prophet his soul will be taken by Allah until he sees his seat in paradise, and then after that he will be given the choice. So when the Prophet ﷺ became ill, and when that moment of death approached, while his head was on my thigh and he used to go into a state of unconsciousness, then wakes up, finally I saw him gazing with his sight up in the direction of the roof, the ceiling. Then he said, Allahumma rafiq al-a'la, O Allah, the highest companionship, meaning he had chosen Allah to be with Allah. So I said, Aisha said, إِذَنْ لَا يَخْتَارُنَا, so he didn't choose us. And I knew that this is what he used to say concerning the prophets. She said then, Allahu Akbar. She said, فَكَانَتْ تِلْكَ آخِرَ كَلِمَةٍ تَكَلَّمَ بِهَا النَّبِيُّ صلى الله عليه وسلم. This was the last word that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke, اللهم الرفيق الأعلى. O Allah, the most highest companionship, that means Allah himself. So how is it that, you know, these rough hearts, these stone hearts are unable to accuse other Muslims when they speak about knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's names and attributes and defending them in the proper way as Allah intended and as Allah affirmed for himself and by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has their influence in the heart or in the hearts that they know, that knows of him. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh, sister Niqabis. Because this person would start observing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that he knows of him, that he encompasses all of his affairs, and therefore in this respect his state of shy of bashfulness will develop, and he will be shy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicated that a person would not indulge in sin except when his heart at such moments will be free of iman, it will lack faith, and that's why he will indulge in concluding the sin, as in the hadith of Abi Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he said, the one who commits adultery, when he does not do it while he is in a state of iman, while he is being a believer. And so the same with the thief, when he steals. And so with the person who takes the alcoholic drinks. And the interpretation of this was given vividly, alaykum salam, rahmatullahi ta'ala, barakatuh, patience is beautiful, by Ibn Abbas, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, when he was asked, كَيْفَ يُنْزَعُ الْإِيمَانُ مِنْهُ, how is it that belief is taken away from him, meaning when he indulges in this sinful deed? He said like this, and he meshed his fingers together, then he pulled them apart. So if he repents, it will retain like this, and then he remeshed them together, meaning the iman will return to him. that's why in the story of Noah, which we discussed last night, when Noah invocated Allah, rather when he invoked, when he called his people and they didn't respond in the correct way and believe in his message, he knew that they were doing so because they didn't really know of Allah the proper knowledge that he deserves. He said, مَا لَكُمْ لَا تَرْجُونَ لِلَّهِ وَقَارًا, مَا لَكُمْ لَا تَرْجُونَ لِلَّهِ وَقَارًا, what is the matter with you that you don't believe in Allah and that you don't respect him, the respect he deserves, by submitting to him and believing in him subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that you don't hope for reward from him. That is because creation, if they would have the proper estimation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and having the good opinion of him, they would not indulge in any kind of shirk, because all good is in his hand. So how come they will go and seek other than him? When he said, وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا عِنْدَنَا خَزَائِنُهُ, nothing, there is nothing except that we have all the treasures of it. So why people go and then resort to other than him? Because they didn't really have the proper knowledge which leads to the proper estimation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he deserves. And there is not a thing but with us are the stores thereof. Surah Al-Hijr, which is Surah 15, verse 21. And because all this evil, it is only Allah who can protect them from it. As we know from the saying of Allah in Surah Az-Zumar, أليس الله بكاف عبده ويخوفونك بالذين من دونه. Isn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala suffice for his slaves? Chapter 39, verse 36. Certainly he is most sufficient. Is not Allah sufficient for his slave? وَيُخَوِّفُونَكَ بِالَّذِينَ مِن دُونِهِ. Yet they try to frighten you with those whom they worship besides him, and whom Allah sends astray, for him there will be no guide. So if if people really give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the proper estimation that He deserves, then their hearts will be filled with awe, so that you wouldn't see any of them committing sin. As Sa'id ibn Jubayr rahimahullah said, إِنَّ الْخَشْيَةَ أَن تَخْشَى اللَّهِ حَتَّى تَحُولَ خَشْيَتُكَ بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَ مَعْصِيَتِكَ فَتِلْكَ الْخَشْيَةَ. Awe and fear and having awe means that for it to be true, عليكم السلام ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته, it should keep you away from indulging in that sin. And this is the true aw. And remembrance, ta'atullah, and the dhikr, ta'atullah, and the remembrance is obedience to Allah. So anyone who obeys Allah has remembered Him. وَمَنْ لَمْ يُطِعْهُ فَلَيْسَ بِذَاكِرٍ. And anyone who doesn't obey Him, then indeed he is not really in remembrance of Him. Even though he can make abundant tasbih and abundant recitation of Quran. And in these words, really, there is a very important meaning that we should really give thought to. And that is, the slave does not commit the sin except if he is heedless about observing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not giving thought that Allah sees and hears him, and he is being overwhelmed by the eagerness to commit the sin. But if he remembers Allah, if he remembers that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees him and knows all of his moves, he can remember the saying of Allah, أَلَمْ يَعْلَمْ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَرَى. Doesn't he know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees? So his saying, meaning Sa'id bin Jubayr rahimahullah, saying, فَمَنْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهَ فَقَدْ ذَكَرَهُ, then anyone who remembers, who obeys Allah, then indeed he has remembered him. He is referring to the essence of remembrance and its base, which is the heart. عليكم السلام ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. And that's the thing which will instigate the obedience. As Maymoon bin Mahran rahimahullah said, الذكر ذكران. Remembrance is of two types. ذكر اللسان حسن. Remembrance by the tongue, and this is good. But what is best? وأفضل من ذلك أن يذكر الله العبد عند المعصية فيمسك عنها. That the slave of Allah remembers Allah at the time of the act of disobedience, and then he holds from committing it. So what we are saying here is that obedience and ceasing from committing sin all relates to the knowledge of Allah and having awe and observing Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. This also has another benefit, that this knowledge of Allah leads the person to strive in worship. This is the third thing. Leads the believer to strive in worship of Allah. Comprehend the state of those whom Allah described in Surah Al-Dhariyat, chapter 57, verse 17 and 18. Chapter 57, verse 17 and 18. كانوا قليلا من الليل ما يهجعون وبالأسحار هم يستغفرون. Surah Al-Dhariyat, which is 51, chapter 51 rather. Chapter 51, verses 17 and 18. They used to sleep but little by night, invoking their Lord Allah and praying with fear and hope. وَبِالْأَسْحَارِ هُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ, and in the hours before dawn they were found asking Allah for forgiveness. They knew of Allah, and that led them to strive in the worship of Allah. And that's why now we know that the person who commits the sin is the one who didn't really give the proper estimation in due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as in Surah Az-Zumar, chapter 39, verse 67, which I recited earlier. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ وَالْأَرْضُ جَمِيعًا قَبْضَتُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَالسَّمَاوَاتُ مَطْوِيَّاتٌ بِيَمِينِهِ. Brother Abu Turab, if you could paste that, please. 39, Surah Az-Zumar 39, 67. They made not a just estimate of Allah such as is due to Him, and on the day of resurrection the whole of the earth will be grasped by His hand, and the heavens will be rolled up in His right hand. Glorified is He, high is He above all that they associate as partners with Him. Jazakallah khair. Ignorance by not giving the estimate of Allah such as is due to Him is the greatest form of ignorance. And this is the reason, and it's the means by which the slave can transgress the limits set by Allah. That's why Allah in Surah Al-Hajj, Surah 22, verse 30 said, ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ حُرُمَاتِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ. Surah 22, verse 30. That is obligation that mankind owes to Allah, and whoever honors the sacred things of Allah, then that is better for him with his Lord. And in chapter 4, Surah An-Nisa, chapter 4, verse 17. So this is the fourth point here, is that ignorance stems from the and from the improper knowledge. Ignorance stems from the improper knowledge of Allah, which leads to an improper estimation of Him. Now we cite chapter 4, verse 17. إنما التوبة على الله للذين يعملون السوء بجهالة. Chapter 4, verse 17, Surah An-Nisa. Allah accepts only the repentance of those who do evil in ignorance and foolishness and repent soon afterwards. That's why one of the early scholars of Islam said that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to say, "Kullu dhanbin asabahu 'abdun fahuwa bi jahala." Yes. Kullu 'abdin aw kullu dhanbin asabahu 'abdun fahuwa bi jahala. That every sin committed by a slave is due to ignorance. And such was the saying of Qatada, who said that the companions of the Prophet ﷺ اجتمعوا على ذلك, had been in agreement concerning this. And this is reported by Abdul Razak in his tafsir and Ibn Jarir in his tafsir and Bi-Isnad al-Hasan. Look who's here, mashallah. Brother G Force is here, mashallah. Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. MashaAllah. We hope that everything is all well with you, Brother G-Force. And consider this room your room. So this is the understanding of the Sahaba, this is the fiqh of the Sahaba concerning the Book of Allah. Because they knew in this respect, Naam, Alhamdulillah, the influence of Tawheed and the purification of the souls. So, As-Suddi, when he read this verse, إِنَّمَا التَّوْبَةُ عَلَى اللَّهِ لِلَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ السُّوءَ بِجَهَالَةٍ, which was cited earlier in the translation of the meaning, Allah accepts only the repentance of those who do evil in ignorance and foolishness and repent soon afterwards. He said, مَا دَامَ يَعْصِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ جَاهِلٍ. As long as he commits sins and disobeys Allah, then he is ignorant. And that's why Ibn Taymiyyah, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, the renowned scholar of Islam, said, what's meant here is that every disobedient person is ignorant, and everyone who has awe and fear of Allah, then he is knowledgeable of Allah, being in obedience to him. And that he, the one who is disobedient, he is jahil, ignorant. Why? لِنَقْصِ خَوْفِهِ, because of the diminishing of fear. He is not in the perfect state of fear, but in a lesser state. And therefore, إِذْ لَوْ تَمَّ خَوْفُهُ مِنَ اللَّهِ لَمْ يَعْصِ. Had his fear of Allah being perfected, he wouldn't disobey him. So the fifth point, therefore, the more a believer, the more a believer is knowledgeable of Allah, the more he fears him. And this is in accordance of the saying of Allah, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ, as in Surah Az-Zumar, chapter 39, verse 28. Chapter 39, verse 28. Brother Ayman or Abu Talib, if you can place that, inshallah. Zumar 39 and verse 28, or it could be I think it's, maybe I have given you the wrong citation. It will be Fatir, rather Az-Zumar, it will be Fatir. Fatir, but number 28. I'm sorry, it's Fatir. Surah Fatir, and it's verse 28. And Fatir is number 35. Number 35. So this would be then Quran 25. And it is only those who have knowledge amongst his slaves that fear Allah, fear him most. And وَأَعْلَمُ الْعُلَمَاءِ, the most knowledgeable of the people who know of Allah is Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he used to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yet he is what he is. Because Allah ordered him to say, as in Surah Al-An'am, verse 15, قُلْ إِنِّي أَخَافُ إِنْ عَصَيْتُ رَبِّي عَذَابَ يَوْمٍ عَظِيمٍ. Say, indeed, I fear that if I disobey Allah, my Lord Allah, I fear a day of severe punishment. Chapter Surah Al-An'am, verse 15. Because the believers in the Tawheed of Allah, the those who know of Allah, even if these sins are so minute, they will feel it like mountains. Because, why? Because their knowledge of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why the generation of the companions, since they knew the rights of Allah and they knew him very well, they used to be those who feared him most. Look what Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, إِنَّكُمْ لَتَعْمَلُونَ أَعْمَالًا هِيَ أَدَقُّ فِي أَعْيُنِكُمْ مِنَ الشَّعْرِ. Now you do certain deeds that you think of it to be so fine, so minute in your eyes, finer than the hair. Yet إِنَّ كُنَّا لَنَعُدُّهَا عَلَىٰ عَهْدِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ مِنَ الْمُوبِقَاتِ. Yet we used to consider them at the time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم as from the mubiqat, meaning from the destructive ones. As Imam al-Bukhari explained the meaning of mubiqat, يعني المهلكات, meaning to be the destructive ones. And as Imam al-Awza'i, the great scholar of Islam, rahimahullah, said, سمعت بلال بن سعد يقول, I heard بلال بن سعد عليكم السلام رحمة الله تعالى وبركاته أبو أفنان, saying, لا تنظر إلى صغر الخطيئة ولكن انظر إلى من عصيت. No voice, try to reboot. Don't look how belittle is your sin, but look to the one who, and contemplate the one who, whom you disobeyed. Allahu Akbar. That's why Satan, if he is tired of a person, of a believer from committing sins, seeing him devoted to Allah, he will resort to other tricks. He will resort to speaking highly of him so that he may instigate in him, show off, and riya. Therefore, continues with this until the moment of his death. He will continue working on him from the side of disobedience, and if he feels that he's unable to get him through that, he will come to, you know, get him through pride, show off, and so forth. And there is a very interesting story that Abdullah bin Ahmad bin Hanbal, Abdullah, the son of the great Imam of Islam, Ahmad bin Hanbal, he said, when death reproached my father, I came close to him and I sat by his side, and I have a piece of cloth with me. I looked at him and I saw him going unconscious until I think that he, and I thought that he, you know, passed away. Then he awakes and says, and he says, La ba'd, not yet. He did this once and twice. And while he was in the third one, I said to him, Ya Abati, O my father, what is this that you are saying now? He said, O son, Ya Bunay, Ma Tadri, you don't know. I said, no, I don't know. He said, Iblis La'anahu Allah, Satan, may he receive the curse of Allah, قَامَ بِحِذَاءِ عَضًا عَلَىٰ أَنَامِلِهِ, he stood by my feet and biting his fingers, saying, يَا أَحْمَدْ O أَحْمَدْ فُتَّنِي, meaning, you were saved from me, you were saved from me. Why he's saying this at this time of death? He's saying to Ahmed that you were protected, you were saved from me. Why? In order to lead Ahmed, you know, to feel something about himself, feeling pride, and you know, and this is an affliction. Now he's trying to cause an affliction now, fitna, to Ahmed at the time of his death. And that's why I said, La ba'd, hatta amut, not before until I die. What from me? That's why we remember the what he said. Okay, he said, he told him, O Ahmed, you know, إِنَّكَ قَدْ نَجَوْتَ مِنِّي, you were saved from me, from my plot. And I used to tell him, I responded to him, replied, لَا بَعْد حَتَّى أَمُوت, not yet, before I die, until I die, then I will, inshallah, I will be saved from you. But not now. And this really is one of the fruits of Iman, of true Iman, that Allah will give the believer at the time of death steadfastness against Satan and against the temptations of Satan. And this has been explained by our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he recited the verse, يثبت الله الذين آمنوا بالقول الثابت في الحياة الدنيا وفي الآخرة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make the believers steadfast with the firm saying in this life and in the hereafter. And this firm saying in this life is being able to express the testimony of faith at the time of death. At the time of death. And also at the time of questioning in the grave. Since every person, after being buried, he will be asked three questions. Who is your Lord? Man Rabbuk? Ma Deenuk? What is your religion? And what is the name of this person that was sent to you, meaning as a messenger? Those whom Allah will give steadfastness and fairness will be able to answer that. And who are these ones? They will be the true believers. They will be the true believers. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those whom He will give steadfastness in this life and in the hereafter. That's why Imam Ibn al-Qayyim said, فَالتَّوْحِيدُ أول ما يدخل به في الإسلام, meaning the person, the first thing that a person will enter through or by it is Tawheed, into Islam, into the fold of Islam. وآخر ما يخرج به من الدنيا, and it is the last thing that he will, you know, leave at the time when he leaves this life. That's why the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man kana akhiru kalamihi la ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah." And that's why Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "The one whose the final words that he will utter, if there will be la ilaha illallah, the testimony of faith, then he will enter paradise." We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who will utter La ilaha illallah at the time of their death. And that's why the believer who lives on the pure tawheed and does not mix it and mingle it in any kind of distortions, Allah will make him die on that state. Especially those who call for this tawheed and defend it. Al-Hafidh Abdul Ghafir Al-Farisi rahimahullah, one of the scholars of Islam, said, I entered to see Abi Bakr al-Labbad sa'at mawtihi, one of the righteous Muslims by the name of Abi Bakr al-Labbad. At the time of his death, he said, I entered to see him. فَسَمِعْتُهُ يَقُولُ وَهُوَ يَجُودُ بِنَفْسِهِ, I heard him saying while he was, you know, exerting himself at the times of death, الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن, الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن, الملك, the king, القدوس, the one who is free, the pure, the most pure, السلام, the one who is safe from all defects, المؤمن, the one who is trustworthy, Allah, these are names of Allah, فعد الأسامي إلى آخرها, and so he named all the names of Allah until he died. And in this respect, we end this talk by remembering what was the will of Ibrahim and of Yaqub, of Jacob, to his sons, as in chapter 22, verse 132-133, chapter 2, Surah Al-Baqarah, 132-133. ووصى بها إبراهيم بنيه ويعقوب يا بني إن الله اصطفى لكم الدين فلا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أم كنتم شهداء إذ حضر يعقوب الموت إذ قال لبنيه ما تعبدون من بعدي قالوا نعبد إلهك وإله آبائك إبراهيم وإسماعيل وإسحاق ويعقوب إبراهيم وإسماعيل وإسحاق إلها واحدا ونحن له مسلمون. And this submission to Allah in Tawheed was enjoyed by Ibrahim, by Abraham, upon his sons, and by Yaqub, by Jacob, saying, O my sons, Allah has chosen for you the true religion, then die not except in the faith of Islam as Muslims in Tawheed. Or were you witnesses when death approached Yaqub, Jacob, when he said unto his sons, what will you worship after me? They said, we shall worship your Ilah, God, Allah, the God of your fathers, Ibrahim, Ismail, Ishaq, Isaac, and one Ilah, one God, and to him we submit in Islam. So this is the greatest and most fruitful end to be on a state of Islam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who know of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and estimate him the proper estimation he deserves, and to make us from those who live on this, call to it and defend it and die on it and be resurrected on it. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullahu khair. And we would appreciate Brother G-Force if he